It's really just in awe of what machine learning is capable of in how we can extend human capabilities. And we want to think more than just about, you know, discovering new approaches and new ways of using the technology. We want to see how it's being used and how it impacts the human creative process. So imagine you need to find or compose a drum pattern. You have some idea of a drum beat that you would like to compose. And all you need to do now is go to a website where there's a pre-trained model of drum patterns sitting on the online. You just need a web browser. You give it some human input, and you can generate a space of expressive variations. You can tune and control the type of outputs that you're getting from this generative model. And if you don't like it, you can continue going through it, exploring this generative space. So this is the type of work that Project Magenta focuses on. To give you a bird's eye view of what Project Magenta is about, it basically is a group of researchers and developers and creative technologists that engage in generative models research. So you'll see this work published, machine learning conferences, you'll see the workshops, you'll see a lot of research contributions from Magenta. You'll also see the code that, after it's been published, put into open source repository on GitHub in the Magenta repo. And then from there, we'll see ways of thinking and designing creative tools that can enhance and extend the human expressive creative process. And eventually ending up into the hands of artists and musicians in inventing new ways we can create and inventing new types of artists. So I'm going to give three brief overviews of the highlights of some of our recent work. So this is Performance RNN. How many people have seen this? This is one of the demos earlier today. A lot of people have seen and heard of this kind of work. And this is what people typically think of when they're thinking of a generative model. They're thinking, how can we build a computer that has the kind of intuition to know the qualities of things like melody and harmony, but also expressive timing and dynamics. And what's even moreover, it's even more interesting now to be able to explore this for yourself in the browser, enabled by TensorFlow.js. So this is a demo we have running online. We have the ability to tune and control some of the output that we're getting. So in a second, I'm going to show you this video of what that looks like. You would have seen it out on the demo floor, but we'll show you and all of you watching online. And we were also able to bring it even more alive by connecting a baby grand piano disc clavier that is also a MIDI controller. And we have the ability to perform alongside the generative model, reading in the inputs from the human playing the piano. So let's take a look. So this is trained on classical music data from actual live performers. This is from a data set that we got from a piano competition. If you notice, this is Nikhil from earlier today. He's actually quite a talented young man. He helped build out the browser version of Performance RNN. And so we're thinking of ways that we take bodies of work, we train a model off of the data, then we create these open source tools that enable new forms of interaction, of creativity, and of expression. And this is all these points of engagement are enabled by TensorFlow. The next tool I want to talk about that we've been working on is the variational autoencoders. How many people are familiar with latent space interpolation? OK, quite a few of you. And if you're not, it's quite simple. You take human inputs, and you train it through a neural network, compressing it down to an embedding space. So you compress it down to some dimensionality, and then you reconstruct it. So you're comparing the reconstruction with the original and trying to train, build a space around that. And what that does is that creates the ability to interpolate from one point to another, touching on the intermediate points where a human may have not given input. So the machine learning model may have never seen an example that it's able to generate, because it's building an intuition off of these examples. So you can imagine if you're an animator, there's so many ways of going from cat to pig. How would you animate that? So we're trained, there's an intuition that the artist would have in creating that sort of morphing from one to the other. So we're able to have the machine learning model now also do this. We can also do this with sound, right? This technology actually carries over to multiple domains. So this is nSynth, and we've released this, I think, sometime last year. And what it does is take that same idea of moving one input to another. So let's take a look. You'll get a sense of it. Piccolo to electric guitar. So rather than recomposing or fading from one sound to the other, what we're actually able to do is we're able to find these intermediary recomposed sound samples and produce that. So it looks, you know, there's a lot of components to that. There's a WaveNet decoder, but really it's the same technology underlying the encoder-decoder variational autoencoder. But when we think about the types of tools that musicians use, we think less about, you know, training machine learning models. We see like drum pedals, right? Guitar pedals, these knobs and these pedals that are used to tune and refine sound to cultivate the kind of art and flavor a musician is looking for. We don't think so much about setting parameter flags or trying to write lines of Python code to create the sort of art, you know, in general. So what we've done, not just are we interested in finding and discovering new things, we're also interested in how those things get used in general, used by practitioners, used by specialists. And so we've created a hardware, we've taken a piece of hardware where we've taken the machine learning model, we've put it into a box where a musician can just plug in and explore this latent space in performance. So let's take a look at how musicians feel, what they think in this process.
Now it does feel like we're turning a corner of what could be new possibilities. It could generate a sound that might inspire us.
The fun part is, like, even though you think you know what you're doing, there's some weird interaction happening that's like can give you something totally unexpected.
I mean, it's great research, and it's really fun, and it's amazing to discover new things, but it's even more amazing to see how it gets used and what people think to create with alongside it. And so what's even better is that it's just released, nSynth Super, in collaboration with the Creative Lab London. It's an open source hardware project. All the information and the specs are on GitHub. We talk about everything from potentiometers to the touch panel to the code and what hardware it's running on. And this is all available to everyone here today. You just go online and you can check it out yourself. Now, music is more than just sound, right? It's actually a sequence of things that goes on. So when we think about this idea of what it means to have a generative music space, we think also about melodies. And so just like we have cat to pig, what is it like to go from one melody to the next? And moreover, once we have that technology, what does it look like to create with that? You have this expressive space of variations. How do we design an expressive tool that takes advantage of that? And what will we get out of it? So this is also another tool that's developed by another team at Google to make use of melodies in a latent space, so how interpolation works, and then building a song or some sort of composition with it. So let's take a listen. Say you have two melodies. And then the middle. You can extend it. And we really are just scratching the surface of what's possible. How do we continue to have the machine learn and have a better intuition for what melodies are about? So again, to bring it back full circle, we have using different compositions and musical works, we're able to train a variational autoencoder to create an embedding space that builds tools that enable open source communities to design creative artist tools to look at new ways of pushing the expressive boundaries that we currently have. This is, again, just released. It's on our blog. All the code is open source and made available to you, and also enabled by TensorFlow. In addition to all these other things, including Nikhil, here enabled by the type of work in creativity and expressivity. And so in wrapping up, I want to take us back to this demo that we saw. Now, the most interesting and maybe the coolest thing about this demo was that we didn't even know that it was being built until it was tweeted by Taro, a developer from Finland. And the fact of the matter is that we're just like barely scratching the surface. There's so much to do, so much to engage in, and so much to discover. And we want to see so much more of this. We want to see more developers, more people sharing things, and more people getting engaged. Not just developers, but artists and creatives as well. We want to explore and invent and imagine what we can do with machine learning together as an expressive tool. And so to go to our website, g.co/magenta, there you'll find our publications and these demos. You can experience it yourself and more. And you can also join our discussion group. So here's g.co/magenta. Join our discussion group, become part of the community, and share the things that you're building so we can do this alongside together. Thank you so much. So that's it for the talks today. We've had an amazing, amazing show, amazing spread of speakers and topics. Now let's take a look at a highlight review of the day.
Earlier this year, we hit the milestone of 11 million downloads. You know, really excited to see how much users are using this and how much impact it's having in the world.
We're very excited today to announce that DeepLearn.js is joining the TensorFlow family.
Swift for TensorFlow is also an early stage project, and so we'd really love for you to get interested and help us to build this future.
I told you at the beginning that our mission for TF Data was to make a library for input processing that is fast, flexible, and easy to use.
So I'm very excited to say that we have been working with other teams in Google to bring TensorFlow Lite to Google Apps.
In general, the Google Brain team's mission is to make machines intelligent and then use that ability to improve people's lives. I think these are good examples of where there's real opportunity for this.